Welcome to Blaze the Trail Podcast, bringing you authentic and vulnerable stories that will inspire you to breathe fire on this world and become your own hero. Here's your host, Blaze Hunter.
Hello, welcome to Blaze the Trail Podcast. I'm Blaze Hunter, and I am a fertility expert. No, I don't help people get pregnant. This is a different type of expertise. I actually inspire women to birth confidence, to birth their books and business ideas, dreams, passions, and goals, as well as discover peace amongst infertility. After going through my own sets of traumas and tragedies, dealing with a rare disease, and experiencing 3 miscarriages, I decided to take charge of my life and not let life happen to me, but rather become the hero of my own life. I am not barren. I continually birth my purpose every day. So that's why I've created this show, to demonstrate how even though we all experience setbacks and disappointments, we still have a destiny to birth. We just need to blaze the trail and be expecting. This podcast will inspire you to lean into your hardships and allow them to be the vehicle that transports you into becoming the hero of your life, so you can breathe fire on this world. This week's episode is called The Art of Fertility. And some points we'll cover are dealing with infertility and the mindset of an artist, 4 steps to taking control of your fertility journey, and how to have peace and joy even amongst the pain. And I have my friend here, Jasmine Katatikar, here to speak on this topic. Jasmine is a fertility warrior who struggled to have a child for 6 years. After multiple IUIs and her second IVF, she was told that she had less than 1% chance of having a baby and to stop trying. However, Jasmine didn't give up. Using her background as an artist, she applied an artist mindset to overcome her roadblocks and design a life that gave control of her fertility journey and life moving forward. As a result, she became pregnant within months of being told she had less than 1% chance. Today, Jasmine now has 2 children, both through IVF. Using her designer point of view and tools, Jasmine shows how to take control of your own fertility journey as well. Welcome, Jasmine, to the show.
Hi, Blaze. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for joining me. You know, it's always a pleasure to meet and discuss things with people that have gone through similar hardships and have leaned into their struggles, but then also found their purpose amongst their pain. And that's exactly what you've done. And I just applaud you for that. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. And thank you for your podcast. I feel like our ideas and voices are very much aligned in, you know, finding the reward in pain and journey. I mean, that sounds odd to say, but, you know, a lot comes out of struggles and journeys, and I am very passionate about sharing what I learned in my own journey. So that's why I am so excited to be here today.
Absolutely. And I always say, like, no grit, no pearl. Like, if you don't have those grits and those problem issues and those hardships, then you have no opportunity to create a pearl. And so we have to shift that perspective. I know it's so hard, and no, we don't want pain and wish pain and problems upon our lives, but it is a part of life. It is our reality. We're not going to have this rosy rainbow life. It is filled with different challenges and setbacks, and we have to learn to draw on those issues, those hardships, the pain, and let it be our pearl versus take us out and not live to our fullest potential and live out our purpose. And that's what you're doing with your life. So you're a true testament of digging in, having grit, and creating a pearl for your life. So I just, again, applaud you for your contributions to life, being vocal about it. This is a taboo topic still in this day and age, and we're getting loud about it on Blaze the Trail podcast. And yeah, we just wanted to maybe hear about a little bit more of your backstory and your infertility journey and what that defining moment was that led you to change the narrative of your story.
Yeah, I'd be happy to share my fertility journey and what brought me here and what I learned through it. To start, by profession, I am a lighting artist on feature animated films. So if you've seen movies like Ice Age, Rio, Ferdinand, and Spies in Disguise, things like that, those are the type of movies I've worked on. And growing up, I had a pretty good childhood. I'm not gonna lie. You know, I was fed I grew up in New York, and I was kind of, you know, fed that social norm where the idea of happy and successful is, you know, get a good education, get a good career, get married, have, you know, 2.5 kids, and work really hard and retire. And I was definitely along that path, kind of almost like blindly going along that path, to be honest with you. And I was checking all the boxes I thought I should check. I went to a good school. I had a good career. I got married. And when the time came to have kids, you know, I still remember how naive I was about it. My personality is I like to control things. I like to plan things. So, and I still kind of smile at how naive I was in that plan and how things don't necessarily go the way that you plan, but it's actually a good thing. So I feel like if my plan had gone the way it was planned initially, I'd be a lesser person for it, to be honest with you, and with not ever getting to know myself. Because I feel like what these struggles end up doing is really force you to stop and reflect and figure out what's really important for you and start thinking for yourself too. Because as I said, I was just kind of going along this path of what I was fed, what I was told when I was a young child, like, this is the path to happiness. This is what you need to do. You know, I never questioned it. So at 30, I started trying. I still remember being shocked. I wasn't pregnant within the first month of trying, right? I was just like, what happened? And then, you know, then a couple more months went by, 9 months went by. I was getting, you know, I was getting a bit concerned. And so a little under a year, I went to the doctor. And I was starting to get really nervous about it, as, you know, any normal person would when they're trying and something's not working out for them. And they did all the tests. They ran all the, you know, normal tests on me and my husband, and nothing came out abnormal. And they said, you know, everything looks good. So right now there is probably something going on since it's been a year, but we can't find anything. So they diagnosed me with unexplained infertility at that point in my journey. And they suggested that we go ahead and do some IUIs to kind of move things along and, you know, give us a better chance of getting pregnant. So we were optimistic at this point. We were still, you know, 31, 32 in the journey, and they didn't take. And at first I was like, you know, with any fertility journey, you go through like ups and downs, like hopes, like every month you hope this might be the month, right? And then it doesn't happen, and you have to pump yourself back up again. So we did this, and we did, it's honestly a little bit of a blur now, but we probably did around 3 to 4 IUIs at this one clinic. And in the meantime, we were also kind of, you know, trying, and another year went by. And at this point, it was suggested that maybe we should go to IVF. And at this point, we were ready for it. And this is when I first realized that maybe all clinics were not the same in a way where, you know, especially when it deals with going into IVF. And I didn't realize this. It was my father, who is a doctor, who actually suggested that if we're going to go to IVF, we should change clinics because the labs are very important when you are dealing with IVF, and a bigger institution might have, you know, better resources for that. So that was a surprise to me at first too. And I was like, oh, that makes sense, right? It's not only the doctor, but it's the labs too, and the resources that these clinics have. So we moved clinics, and I still remember talking to this doctor at this kind of well-known institution in New York City, and he was looking at our charts, and he didn't see anything wrong. He was very optimistic for our chances. And this is, you know, I'm 34 at this point probably, and I'm all set, and we go through the IVF cycle, and had about 8 or 10 viable eggs that were retrieved, and probably, you know, 6 of them fertilized. By day 2, I think 4 of them were progressing, day 2, day 3. So I had the appointment to go in to get the transfers for day 5. And I still remember I was really like out the door. And I was so excited to get my transfer because this is my first IVF. I'm like, this is it. This is going to be the day, you know. And we got a phone call, and it was a nurse from the clinic. And she said to us, she said to me on the phone, like, don't come in. And I remember being really confused. I was like, what? But I'm getting my transfer today. And she said, none of the embryos made it to day five. So there's going to be no transfer today. I felt like I did all this work, right? And I never even made it on the field. It was almost like, you know, you work if you're on a sports team. I used to play sports. So I always equated to like, you know, you work so hard doing practice and everything, and you put in everything, but then you never make it into the game. You're just sitting on the sidelines, you know, so you never know, you know, how that hard work will pay off. We went into the office that next day, and the doctor sat with us, and she said, well, we have a new diagnosis for you. It's no longer unexplained infertility. I think it's poor egg quality. Because as they saw through the IVF, the eggs didn't progress, the embryos didn't progress past, you know, day two, three. Mm-hmm. And that's a sign of poor egg quality. And of course, my first, you know, what's everyone's first question to something that when they found out what the problem was, because mm-hmm. with unexplained, you know, you're kind of just shooting in the dark, and it's really frustrating not knowing that there is something wrong, but you don't know what it is, so you don't know how to solve it. And then in this regard, like finally I was like, oh, okay, it's poor egg quality. So my next question was like, well, how can I improve that? And her answer was, you can't, which is not the answer that anyone really wants, right?
No, you want the fix, right?
Exactly. And then I remember I was like pushing her, and I was like, there has to be a way to improve egg quality. And this is where she like kind of reluctantly was like, well, some people, you know, think, say acupuncture can help. So, you know, at this point I would have done anything. If she would have said like, go stand, hop on one foot over there for 5 minutes, that's going to improve your egg quality, I would have done it, you know? So I was like, okay, I'm going to do acupuncture. And she, before the next IVF cycle to try again. So I did go to an acupuncturist at this point. I had played with it a little bit like in years previously, but I never really took it that seriously. And I went to a fertility acupuncturist, and she put me on a very kind of like a 3-month detox essentially of my body, where we changed my diet completely. The idea was to like, you know, really detox my body, get it ready for the next IVF cycle, and prepared. So hopefully, you know, to increase my egg quality. So I did that for 3 months, and, you know, the next round came for my second IVF, and I was all set. I was like, I've worked so hard, you know, and regardless, I will say through the journey, like, I felt it made me healthier. Like doing this detox was, I thought about this while I was doing the detox. I'm like, regardless of what happens, like, I'm feeling pretty good. Like, I'm investing in myself and learning a lot more about myself. Also, during this time, it was like a big time of reflection and, you know, why do I really want this child and what do I really want in life, right? Instead of going through just the motions blindly. So I went 3 months, and I was ready for the IVF, the second IVF, and it was pretty much very similar to the first one. Nothing different stood out. And it was the morning of the day five transfer, which is the same exact thing. You know, I retrieved about the same amount of eggs, around the same amount of eggs fertilized. I got the call around day two and three for my day five appointment, and it was almost identical, like a Groundhog's Day type of thing. But this time I was in my acupuncturist office because I was getting acupuncture before the transfer. And I was really nervous because of what happened previously. And I still remember after my appointment was over, my acupuncturist walked in and she just had this look on her face. And as soon as I saw her face, I was like, tell me. And she said that the clinic called and there's no transfer today. And essentially the same exact thing happened. None of the embryos made it to blastocyst. And I was just devastated. I remember my husband and I walked across the park afterwards back home, and I was crying. And it was during this walk that I told him, you know, that he could go if he wanted to be honest with you. And I totally I meant it, because he was meant to be a dad, and I couldn't be that person that was in his way to become a dad. You know, at this point it was poor egg quality. So, you know, the guilt that I felt too, being the barrier, was really hard. And of course he said no. And we kind of picked ourselves up off, you know, the ground, and just emotionally. And we went back in that next day to see the doctor after these results. And this is like, you know, another thing with fertility is so many ups and downs. Like, you just get emotional. It's an emotional roller coaster, right? You just get flattened. And then, but you're forced to like pep yourself back up again, because you need that hope. You need to keep on going. And I sat down and I remember she started talking, and I expected her to kind of say like, okay, for the next cycle, we're going to do this and this and this. And instead she started going straight to donor eggs and adoption. And I remember like pausing and I said, wait, can I not try for another cycle with my own, you know, my own eggs? And she just looked at me and she said, no, I don't recommend that. And I said, there's got to be a chance. And at this point, you know, I was 35 years old at this point, and I still felt like I was young, you know, and healthy. And when I pressed her, she said, I give you a less than 1% chance if you go with your own eggs. And here I was at 35, or in my, you know, plan by 35, I was supposed to have 3 kids. And instead I'm sitting here in this doctor's office at 35 with no kids, trying for, you know, almost 6 years now, and being told I have a less than 1% chance. We left the office, and, you know, the doctor basically left it with us, like, you know, come back if you're interested with about, you know, egg donors. But otherwise, it was kind of the end of my time with that clinic. You know, I left that office that day probably the lowest in my journey. It was the lowest. And we kissed each other goodbye and we both went to work. I still remember thinking, like, why did I go to work that day? And I cried the whole time on the train on the way to work. And just, you know, and at that point, it just didn't feel like the end. Like, it was, you know, to get that probability is devastating. And I just went to work and I sat there and I thought about, like, my whole journey and everything that had gone on within, like, those last 5 years, nearly 6 years at this point. And I was like, something's just not right. What am I not doing here? As I was sitting at work, a work problem came up, you know, that an obstacle came up. And to get my mind off of it, I was like, okay, let's just tackle all this, you know, let's just focus on work right now, as we usually do to, like, distract ourselves from other things. And I started thinking of how I was tackling this work obstacle, and I realized I approached it in a completely different way than I approach my fertility journey. Like, when I approach something at work with an artistic mindset, it's very much like a creative problem solving way of working for me. And it's about, you know, taking in a lot of information. It's about collaborating, talking with people to get their feedback and different perspectives, and then finding, like, multiple solutions to one problem. And there's always more than one solution. And all of a sudden, like, that was my aha moment. I was like, I have not been looking at my life and my fertility journey through these lenses, right? Through this artistic mindset that I use every day at work. And mm-hmm. yeah, and that, and it's like, this is where there's always multiple solutions. And this is where I stepped back and it kind of empowered me. I was like, let's step back from my situation. I've been, you know, the difference in my fertility is, especially with a doctor, right? With doctors, I feel like, you know, I have all full respect for doctors. My father is a doctor, but they're only human too, right? But I feel like we have this blind trust in them a lot of the times, and we don't question a lot of the things. And in my whole journey, I realized that I was just blindly, you know, just following instructions and not advocating for myself enough, not doing research, not getting multiple opinions. And this is when I was like, I need to change the way I'm approaching my fertility journey, and I'm going to start doing it right now. And the next day I went to my acupuncturist to get her feedback on it and just, you know, talk it out with her. And this is like a great example of getting different perspectives on things, especially someone outside of you, because you're so in it, right? It's really hard to look at your situation from a different point of view. And she was great. We like kind of brainstormed, and she said, you know, maybe that clinic's not right for you. Maybe we should try something else. And she actually, you know, with her expertise, she had knowledge of, you know, a lot of the clinics and doctors within the area. And she actually suggested like a specific clinic. She said, I think this hospital and this doctor would be a good fit for you, actually. And I was like, yep, let's try it. And it's all about, you know, again, with the artist kind of creative problem solving mindset, it's all about just like, don't overthink it. It doesn't have to be perfect. Like, just try, iterate, and see, you know, what works and what doesn't. So I went to this doctor at her suggestion. He did not give me a less than 1% chance, which I really liked. He said, you know, he'd like to try some different things. We went ahead and went straight to IVF. It was my third IVF at this point, and I got pregnant. And it was surreal, like, and it was only a couple months after that appointment where I was sitting in the other doctor's office and she told me that I had less than a 1% chance. And I always think back, like, I could have so easily have given up at that point. At that point, I was 5 years into my journey, you know, multiple IUIs, two IVFs, like all that emotional baggage and everything, and having a doctor tell me that, it would have been so easy to just stop. And now, just a couple months later, I'm sitting there pregnant, and I still think back and I'm like, I can't believe it. So that was my journey. And now I have a 4-year-old daughter from that third IVF. And what happened was, also, I will also say that I kept this all very quiet, my whole fertility journey, and I didn't tell anyone. At the very end, I told my immediate family, but that's it. That was probably my fourth or fifth year I told them. And all they saw was this, you know, perfect life in a way. And I say that because I'm probably getting ahead of myself, but I came out with my journey because of a specific comment that someone posted on, you know, some kind of social media. I forget, it was probably Facebook or something, where I posted a picture of my daughter and someone wrote like, oh, you have the perfect life. Like, I think they actually wrote that. And all of a sudden I like stopped and I was like, oh my God, like from the outside, all anyone saw was, you know, Matt and I, my husband, just traveled like crazy during the time that we were trying to conceive. And that was our outlet. That was our way to cope with things. So all they saw was that we traveled around the world. And then all of a sudden, we have this baby. Oh, of course they think my life is perfect. They didn't know for like 6 years that I was struggling. And that's when I came out with my story, because I wanted people to be aware that, you know, it's not a perfect life. And I didn't want to feed into that social media, you know, look, perfection, where people, like, especially I know when I was trying to conceive, and you would see those, you know, the baby announcements or the pregnant bellies, and it hurts, right?
It does.
And yeah, it hurts so much, but we have to keep it inside. And like, and all the friends or coworkers that, you know, they don't mean to do harm, but they're like playfully joke with you, why aren't you pregnant? Why don't you have kids? And little do they know that I probably just had a failed procedure the following, like the previous day. And it was for all those moments that I was like, I need to come out and I need to tell my story and, you know, make people aware and also make those that are going through it that, you know, they're not alone in this.
You know, we compare people's highlight reels with our own life, and mm-hmm. it's only one part of their life, and we're not showing everything in the background, and no one has a perfect life. Everyone has problems. Everyone has setbacks, and we need to get over that portraying of perfection or not owning that there is a flaw there or something hard you're going through, and just be real and vulnerable, and other people can then match you with your vulnerability, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And I think it's 100 times more powerful to be vulnerable and to show real life. Cause I mean, that's the way it is, right? I feel like now more than anything, now at a time more like people value authenticity mm-hmm. where, you know, that's kind of new, right?
It is.
Yeah. Before it's like, if you showed anything that, you know, was not considered like your, you know, highlight reel, like you said, it would be like, what's going on? Their life's not, you know, why would they show that?
Yeah. Well, and I often talk about shifting our perspectives and swapping out that filter. And I can totally relate with you that I didn't want anyone to know that I was struggling. And I had a different problem than you. I was able to get pregnant, but I couldn't keep them. And mm-hmm. so I felt really like alone and feeling it was my fault and attacked myself and felt like I can't do it. Why can't I get the job done? Why can't I do what women normally do totally effortlessly? And so I really did self-hatred and attacking, but I had to get out of that because I was spiraling in such a depression and bawling every month. And I did have a daughter already. And I just, my light bulb was like, wow, you know, I am grieving over a baby I don't have versus the child I have here that's beautiful and obviously is such a miracle. And so I need to shift this because I need to be present for her. I have a perfect baby girl. So let's, you know, get through this depression and turn it into something and turn it into awareness and a dialogue that we're not barren and we're not alone and we still have things to be a mother of, even if we're not physically producing a baby that moment, right? And it's really focusing on, so that I took that as my journey, but you did more the artist route. And so let's chat about the mindset of an artist and what's included in that and how did you do that?
Oh, yeah, let's, and one, I will say I love everything you said. And one of my favorite quotes is, life is 10% what happens to you and 90% how you respond to it.
Yes.
And I feel like that is very true, especially to what you just said. And, you know, we can't control everything. That's just the facts. But we can control how we respond to it and make it, you know, into our own and make ourselves stronger and more positive in that way. And to answer your question about the artistic approach and my mindset to my fertility journey, it was a turning point for me because it was something that I realized I always had in my tool set. Like I was using it every day, but it's funny, we compartmentalize things, right? Especially when it comes to like work and personal, and where we feel like we have control over certain things, but personal is a very different thing. So when I combined my skills at work with the personal, the artistic mindset is something, one, I will say, preface, you don't have to be an artist or creative in any way to, you know, implement this. I use it as it's a creative way of problem solving. The way it worked with my fertility, and it also can work with life, and I've been continuing to use it in my everyday life, is that you approach any obstacle you have with these four steps. And the first step is to first really figure out what makes you happy. It's about knowing yourself, right? And everyone's unique. What makes someone happy, someone else happy, may not make you happy, you know? So don't, this is where you always, you know, don't want to compare yourself to someone else. Like, really look within, figure out what's your version of happy. And then when you're looking, the second step is when you're looking at, you know, whatever problem or obstacle you're trying to overcome, you want to step back and you want to make sure that you are focusing on the right problem, because otherwise, no matter how much energy you're putting into that, you might not be heading in the right direction. So what this means is, like, let's say, you know, for fertility, you're thinking, well, the problem is I can't get pregnant, or the problem is, you know, I can't keep the pregnancy, right? And you're so focused on that. But if you step back and you're like, well, for me, I thought, like, you know, my problem is I can't get pregnant. And then I step back and I thought to myself, like, well, what would getting pregnant do for me? And I thought, you know, it would allow me to have a child, right? And what would a child, and then you step back, you kind of like kind of keep on going, step back, so you actually get the real meaning of what, why you want this child. And you'll realize that you can attain that reasoning in multiple ways, and not only through, you know, having a child, you can foster it in different ways. And this applies to anything from, like, the simplest, you know, problem that you might be facing to the big problems like fertility. And from there, you want to brainstorm. You want to find creative solutions on how you solve this problem. And this is where it's really important to get different perspectives, and also from not only Western medicine, but like Eastern medicine when it comes to fertility or any medical related things. And you kind of like gather all this information up so you're ready, and not so when you attack your problem, your obstacle, you have multiple solutions available to you. So you're not reliant on just one thing to work out. You're not depending, like, if this doesn't work out, I am not going to be happy. You know, there's always multiple ways. And this is when you take action, you start testing things out. And, you know, if the first thing doesn't work out, then you iterate and you test it again, and you keep on going. And it's a way to always keep yourself moving forward, so you never feel like you're stuck, and there's always a solution.
Absolutely. And I love you said about creative solutions. And we got to even change how our thought process is around fertility, because fertility is being creative. It's creating life. And maybe we're struggling in creating human life, but we can still be fertile in our life and be creative. And when you are struggling in one area, try a different path and create something there. And it channels your energy and shifts your negative into a positive. And oftentimes that does open up other fertile parts of our life as well and help the process. So it really is about changing that narrative, changing the negative toxic thinking, because that will ensure you don't get out of it. You stay in that dark, depressive cloud. And sometimes, like I talk about, when you can't change the circumstance, you have to change how you look at it. We can't change a lot of our hardships. It's just there. So we have to change how we look at it. And I love how you're explaining it there. That's awesome. And, you know, you talk about also your four-step approach to taking control of your fertility journey. What does that include?
Yeah, so the four-step approach, I mean, is essentially, it's very similar. It's basically, you know, taking exactly what you say, like taking control of what you can take control of, right? And what you can take control of is how you think about something, how to reframe it in a positive way, and to find the different solutions for it. And this also includes like facing your fears. So, you know, I feel like the first step is figuring out what your core values are. The second step is reframing, kind of thinking about your situation in a different way, a different perspective. The third step is to figure out what your solutions are, what your creative solutions are. And I like to include kind of what's your worst case scenario, right? Like, I feel like we don't want to think about, I know I didn't want to think about it, like to say, what would happen if I couldn't have a child? And I avoided this question for years, honestly. I thought if I thought about it, it'd be like this awful thing. But when I finally sat down as part of, you know, the taking control of your fertility, it's part of it because it actually empowers you. One, it doesn't make it scary anymore. When you say like, well, what would life look like if I didn't have a child, right? And I did this exercise. And I remember, you know, I came into it really scared. And at the end, I did it with my husband. And we're like, you know what? Life would be okay. I could do this, you know. And we thought of all the other things we could pursue, other ways to mother, right? Instead of being a traditional mother, I thought of other ways I could create. And I actually left that, actually, like, doing that exercise really relieved, like a big weight had come off, because I was like, you know, my worst case scenario is not that bad. And now I had a plan for it too. So it was never, it turned into something not to be fearful of, but like, okay, that's just another possibility. And I have a solution for that, right? So it's this way of relieving yourself of the pressure of one thing working. It's kind of, you said something to the point where, you know, when we free our minds, when we reframe our situations, look at it from different directions, we're relieving this stress. And it allows us to be, and sometimes more for, like, actually get pregnant because,
yeah,
because all of a sudden it's like all that pressure from this has to work. You know, I did that. I'm like, if this doesn't work, that's it. You know, it's, I'm never going to be happy. Like, that's a lot of pressure and stress on you getting pregnant. And once you relieve that pressure from yourself, like, things will happen naturally. I often relate that this approach is similar to how you hear about people, you know, that advice that you want to, when people give you advice like, oh, just stop trying and then you'll get pregnant.
I hate that.
That's the worst, right? I hate it too. I was just like, I hated when people said that. But I like to think of this approach is actually a way where you can keep actively trying, but relieve that pressure and stress. So it's like, I used to joke about it that like, oh, you know, when people tell you to stop trying, you just want to, you know, that's not an option. I'm like, do this approach instead. And it actually relieves that stress that allows you to actually become pregnant while still trying, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. And it doesn't mean you're stopping stressing about it because let's be real. It is a stressor. It is there. We need to stop telling people to stop stressing and teach them how to coexist with that and still move along forward, knowing that stressor, that problem, that frustration is still there, but I'm still going to take a step forward in my life and not be bogged down by the stressors. And, you know, like I said, you can be fertile. We are all mothers of purpose. We are mothers of dreams. We have mothers of passions, of service, of being nurturers. Channel those stressors, that infertility area that you're going through, and channel into an area where you can birth other things. I birthed my book amongst three miscarriages. That's all because I turned it into a gift for myself, for other women. I birthed it. It is part of me. I put my creative energy into that. No, I didn't solve my infertility. I still don't have my second child yet, but I was able to still be fertile. And that's the point I think we're both trying to get across. Like, you were able to get children out of it, but you're also birthing peace, purpose, joy, your identity all throughout the struggle. And I think that's what we have to shift that perspective. Don't you agree?
Exactly. I couldn't agree more. I mean, I feel like, you know, that's the message I want to really get across to people, that success does not mean baby, by no means. Like, what I find successful, and through, you know, the steps that I teach people, is you can get that success through multiple ways.
Yes.
The baby is not the definition. And honestly, I mean, if you are not true to yourself, you don't know your core values, you don't know what's going to make you happy, the baby is not the answer to your happiness either, right? Like, even if you do have that baby, you could not be happy. Like, you can't depend your happiness on someone outside of yourself. But I agree, like, there are so many ways to mother. There's so many ways to fulfill those feelings that you would have from having a child too. And I think that's where I'd love to, you know, like, change the conversation, where the success does not mean having a child. Success is so much more, and you have complete control over it.
Exactly. Oh, I love that. I love this conversation. And let's maybe dive a little deeper about discussing some best tips to be happy and at peace amongst the infertility journey. Because I know it's easier when, I struggled and then I have the baby, and then my joy, there is the joy out of that. Yes, you got your baby. But there's so many people, couples, women that are still in that journey, and it's a length of time has passed and you're still wanting that, and you can still have that dream. I'm not telling anyone not to give up on their dream, but it's tips to still find peace and joy even amongst the problem and coexist with it. So what are some of your best tips to tell people and yourself?
Yes, I totally agree that I also tell people, I'm not telling them that they should stop trying or they should stop for getting pregnant. So my best tips when trying to conceive and to, you know, fulfill those needs is that, one, you can be doing exactly that before you get pregnant. So for example, creating, right? As you mentioned, you birth a child, but you can also birth so many other things. And for me, while I was trying, I created a list, actually, of things that I wanted to create. I wanted to fulfill. Like, it went from very basic things to just, like, I want to learn how to woodwork. I took a woodworking class and a glassblowing class. So, like, ways to fulfill yourself and invest in what, you know, will nurture yourself. And for me, when I was creating my list, one of the lists was, you know, creating a book and helping people in different ways. And I did write a book, actually, and it wasn't related to fertility, but it was related to my career. And to kind of release yourself in those different ways while you're trying. So this time, I really want to, you know, during this time of trying for a child and people's on their fertility journeys, it's really easy to pause, right? It's really easy to think, like, you can't do anything else in life and everything is revolving around this journey. And, you know, you want to just stop and kind of focus all on the journey. But I really recommend people to use this time to think of it as an opportunity, actually, to give yourself permission to invest in yourself and ways to fulfill yourselves in other ways, ways to mother in other ways, and to brainstorm, like, what does that look like? Like, for you, you birth this podcast, you birth this book, like, you create so many amazing things. And I would suggest and recommend to whoever is out there listening, if they're in the middle of their journey trying and you feel like it's just, you know, taking everything out of you, maybe take a pause and think outside, before you were trying to conceive, what did you want to do? What things did you want to create? You know, is there just like a hobby that you always wanted to do? And think of how you can nurture yourself in that way and give back too, like the same things where in my how to control your fertility journey, I do kind of have people brainstorm, like, you know, what would a baby do for you? And a lot of things, it's like, you know, they would, it's a way to nurture someone. It's a role model, for example. And like, you can be a role model now. you can go and mentor someone. You know, like actionable steps like that, where you can do those things right now while you're trying, and it will fill, like, it will fulfill you in ways that you'd be surprised. And yeah, so it's outside, think outside the box in that way.
Totally.
Yeah.
And it totally is, like, just like you said, you can still be a mother. And I even help people, like, that have lost children, you know, stillbirths, babies, infants, you know, up into, you know, teenagers that have just gone through a major trauma and a loss of their children. And maybe it was their only child. And they're looking at me and they're saying, all I ever wanted to do was be a mother. And I'm staring at them and I'm like, you are a mother and you can be a mother still. And that's my encouragement, because you get so sucked into that grief and that darkness. And there's still life for you to nurture and mother, and it does look different and it's not fair, and you wanted your child out of you to be a mother of, but this is where we are, and you can still be a mother, and we got to look and defining being a mother in broad spectrum rather than one niche, right? And that's part of the healing process, because otherwise we are stuck. And we're not moving forward. And look at all the people that you could impact with your love if you just hold that and grieve it forever, like let it out and still be a mother and turn it into your pearl. And part of what my coaching practice is too is that I my tip is that when you feel lost in that grief, in that frustration, what do we do when we normally get lost? We Google Maps it. Right? We always go to Google Maps. So if we're lost in our life and lost in that depression and that frustration, let's map ourselves out of it. Let's go to the map, and I've created the acronym MAPP. And the first one for dealing with infertility, loss, grief, or struggle is sitting in the mess. Because so often, especially women, we get the mess, we get the total overwhelm of feelings, frustrations, crying, and we just want to clean it up. What can I do? I'll go to the gym. I'll exhaust it with exercise. I'll drink it out and drown it out with alcohol. I'll OCD it and clean up my house and create everything in order. But because we're trying to mask the disorder in our lives and the mess of the emotions, and people don't know how to handle your emotions, so they then mask it up and try and fix it for you. So I'm asking people to take that step, sit in the mess. It's okay. It's okay to have a mess of emotions and life circumstances. Just allow it to be in your life rather than do away with it. Coexist with it. Allow it to be there. Recognize it's there. Acknowledge, but also it doesn't define my whole life. It's usually one area. And then we got to accept it, because like we said, so many times you can't change it immediately. So you can't do away with your problem. So to release the death grip of frustration, acceptance is part of it. And then adding passion and love for yourself. Don't beat yourself up that you're having this struggle. So many people are. You're not alone. The world isn't coming after you. It's just a problem that we need to make it into our pearl. So instead of looking at it as a victim, turn it into your victory and add more life and passion and love for yourself, and you will be more fertile in your life. And then finally, change your perception, not the image, because you can't change it. You got to change how you look at it, just like how you did with creating it from an art perspective. And between your tips and my tips, I think that's a great start for people going through this, to create a pathway to acceptance and peace, right? And joy.
Yes, I couldn't agree more. I think that was really well said. And I love your map. I love the Google map.
Thank you. It just gives some tangible thing for people. And like, you've been through this, I've been through this, we've been through this, people. Like, we're talking the talk, we're walking the talk, because we've actually lived it out. We've lived those painful times laying down, crying and sobbing from loss after loss and frustration. And I'm right there with you. You know, Jasmine's right there with you, that we know how it feels and we can empathize, but we're also your cheerleader and your coach, because we have gone to the other side and now we're going to pull you across with us, right?
Yes, I can agree more. I mean, I have definitely been with you guys. I've been in tears, and I am so passionate to share this information, because it took me way too long to realize you know, what we're saying right now. And I just, if we could save anybody, you know, the heartache and give them kind of power in their own journey, it will mean everything. And yeah, I think it's so powerful.
You get a string of women who know their worth beyond having babies, who lean into that and birth things in this world. Wow, what if the power of a movement of women being fertile in all areas of their lives is magical? And that's what I'm doing with my heroine movement, is that's what I want. A string, a line of women roaring and being fertile and producing so many things in this life. Isn't that amazing?
It would be, it's amazing. And I can't wait to see. I mean, I feel like, you know, it's starting. Women are definitely birthing and becoming fertile in so many ways. And I can't wait to see all the amazing things that happen from it.
Absolutely. And so what are your things that you're working on? How are you helping people? What are your focuses? What are your goals? What's up next for you?
Yeah, for me, I mean, I am a big advocate of, you know, fertility awareness in general, and sharing my story, sharing that, you know, no, you're not alone in it. And my biggest push right now is to really share this artist mindset to approach your fertility, because honestly, it's not something that I'm seeing out there. Like, I'm still seeing it very much, the talk is around like medicine, what meds are you taking, or, you know, the diet, but mindset, and this specific artist mindset to controlling your fertility is something that I am on a mission to share with people and to change the way that they approach their journey and their life. And I know that it's going to help them in so many ways. And I'm just like really excited to share it with people.
Oh, fabulous. Thank you so much, Jasmine, for coming on the show. If people are struck by your story and want to learn more, do you have an email that they can contact you, or where can they go to reach out to you?
Yeah, they can go to my site at jazzkatat.com. It's JAZZKATAT.com. And there they can get a free fertility training to kind of get them started on this journey.
Wonderful. And I'll provide the link there when we upload this podcast. Thank you so much. Just to recap what we talked about today, dealing with infertility with the mindset of an artist and being fertile in our life, different steps to take control of your fertility journey, how to have peace and joy amongst the pain and still be a mother and birth amazing things and your purpose along our problems and hardships. Thanks again, Jasmine. That's it for this week's episode. Challenge yourself to be vulnerable. Lean into the difficulties and have those open conversations so we can rise up as the heroes of our lives, and let us breathe fire together. If you've enjoyed this show, please subscribe and support Blaze the Trail podcast. Reviews are always welcome and very much appreciated. I have a special gift for everyone. If you head to my website, blazehunter.com, go under free offers tab, there is my map to finding peace and balance amongst a day of stress. And you can do that 10-minute video and get back to balance throughout your day whenever you're feeling overwhelmed with emotions and learning how to coexist with our problems. Thanks for listening. I'm Blaze Hunter.
You've been listening to Blaze the Trail with Blaze Hunter. To learn more about how you can breathe fire and unleash the hero within, or to listen to past episodes, visit blazehunter.com.